here. There's one right here. Is someone sitting here?
Here, yes.
What about there? There's two here. I'm not grabbing enough.
No.
You have to go sit over there.
This is a set.
Assessments.
I
Yeah, I'll pass it over. Good evening, everyone.
Hi, guys. We're gonna be starting in a little while. So I'm waiting for Keisha Robinson to allow to pass out some cards to everyone, and then we'll get started. There's one in the front here, or two here. Welcome, everyone. Hi, I am Charlene Osborne, Program Manager for Region 1. I'm going to be doing a brief session about program assessment. We're going to pass out some index cards to everyone. And as I go along in the presentation, if you have a question, you can put your question on the index card. And with your council's name, we'll try to do all questions at the end, but if we don't, then your program manager will email you the answer to your question at a later time. Affairs, Home and Community Based HCBS Program Assessment Overview. The topics that we're going to be discussing will be the purpose and policy of a program assessment, how to prepare for a program assessment, the documents that you will be reviewing during the program assessment, and what you should expect once the program assessment is complete. The purpose of a program assessment is to ensure that the requirements of the Old American Act of 1965 and GOEA policy and procedure are fulfilled. Just in case you're wondering why a program assessment. Maybe about right here. I'm sorry, guys. So I'll policy and procedure manual, which can be found on goea.la.gov. In section 1207, it discusses monitoring by our office. So it states that your agency shall allow the Governor's Office of Elder Affairs representative to visually inspect your facility and equipment. We shall be permitted to audit, examine all invoices and materials, personal records, and even conditions of employment, and any records pertaining to the projects funded by the Governor's Office of Elder Affairs. Program assessments are completed annually. So once a year, you can expect your program monitor to come out to your COA, AAA, and two senior centers. The assessment usually takes between 2 to 3 days, and beginning this year in October, we're going to be back in the field doing primary program assessments. How to prepare for a program assessment. So you're wondering how you're going to know we're coming out. Well, your program manager will notify the AAA or the Council on Aging Director at least 30 days prior to the program assessment. So we will notify you in a letter if you are the Executive Director. It will include the address of the Council and everything that you will need to know about what the assessment is going to be about. So I'm just going to read the first paragraph of this letter that you should receive. It states that the Home and Community-Based Service Unit, which is HCBS abbreviated, of the Governor's Office of Elder Affairs, GOEA, has developed procedures for monitoring and accessing Area Agency on Aging. The purpose is to determine, number one, that the delivery of the service is in accordance with GOEA policy and procedure. Two, the eligibility criteria for service is in accordance with GOEA policy. And three, that the units of service are being reported accurately and in accordance with, as outlined in GOEA reporting requirements. It will also state the day that the assessment will begin, who will be doing the assessment, and around the date that it should be completed. Also, we're going to be asking you guys to give us a quiet place for the program monitor to work to do the assessment. And any documents that we will be reviewing, there will be an attachment to the letter or enclosed in the envelope, everything that we will be looking at. It will be a document checklist. So when the program assessment begins, the program monitor will meet with the director of the agency to conduct an interest interview. We'll be looking at clients' files for consistency and completion and updating documents. We'll be looking at written policy and procedure, self-monitoring tools, and any active waiting lists that you guys may have. Also, the reason why we're going to be looking at these various files is to see if your agency meets the minimum standards of compliance. So there will be additional documents reviewed during the assessment for single parish AAAs, multi-parish AAAs such as Cajun, Capital, and Sinla, and also Council on Aging that are those that are under the multi. So in this section, I'm going to discuss what are the additional documents needed. So first up, we're going to talk about the additional documents for a single parish AAA during the assessment. So the first thing that we're going to look at is exactly how are you getting the word out to the older Americans in your parish on that you are open for business to help or assist them where needed. Are you advertising in your local paper? Do you have a website? Some people still have phone books in their area. You know, are you running an ad in the phone book like the yellow pages, something like that. If you don't have a website, you also can be using Facebook. I just want to just say, just be careful with Facebook because there are a lot of scammers out there. During the assessment, we're also going to be looking at your grievance procedure. Actually, does your clients of the Council on Aging and AAA know that you have a grievance procedure? Like, what entitles in a grievance procedure? Do they know that? We're going to be checking for that. We're going to need to see the current menu for the month. Also, the sign-in sheet for the congregant meals that you are providing for your participants. We'll be looking at documentation for the service provider monitoring, or if you're doing self-monitoring. If you're direct delivering that service, we're going to need to see those documentations. Also, we're going to look for the assessment from the dietitian for the food service provider. Are the meals in the guidelines that we have set? We're going to look at the logs for in-home services, such as homemaker, chore, telephone, and just to name a few, those activity logs. We're going to also need to see the certification for those employees for those in-home services, because they are required to have first aid certification. You're also supposed to do a background check on those employees and check to see if they are registered in the National Sex Offenders Registry. So we're going to be checking those documentation for the AAA single parent. We're going to be looking at the referral process. Exactly how do you refer a client to different services maybe that you don't supply, or that you don't provide? How do you refer them to other sources? We're going to look at the annual report for the 3D program. For your clients. We're going to look at the employee handbook, employee sign-in sheets, any training logs that you may have for your employees. We're going to need to see that also. The information and assistance tally sheet or the login sheet. Also, if you have a vehicle for your council and if it's not registered with STARS, then we're going to need to see those vehicle logs. Any contracts that you have with service providers. If you're not direct delivering the service, then we're going to need to see those contracts. You should also have a file for your board of directors. We're going to need to see that file, and it should include an approved board roster. GOEA does keep approved board rosters, but when you come for the program assessment, we're going to need to see what roster that you do have on file, any minutes, agendas, flyers that the board had for those meetings. We will be checking that. And last but not least, for the AAA single parish, we're going to be looking for every document that you use to create your area plan. So these will be the additional documents that will be accessed during an assessment for a multi-parish, such as Cajun, Capital, and Zimmer. Some of the documents are similar, but some of them are not. So for the multi-parish, also they have grievance procedures. We're going to be checking that. Their menu for the current month. Also documentation for service provider monitoring and self-monitoring for the AAA. Also the assessment done by the dietitian for the food service provider. In-home services logs for maybe personal care, companion care, visiting, just to name a few. Also, those contracts that they have with their service providers, the AIM report for the 3D program, and any documentation that was used to create the area plan. And that's for the multi, Cajun, Capital, and Cinema. In this section, we'll be reviewing additional documentation for the Council on Agents that are under the multis. And you should have a copy of this presentation in your packet. If you don't and you need a copy, Lakeisha Robinson has a copy of the presentation. So for the Council on Agents that are under the multis, going to be looking at the training logs, signing sheets for your employees, also the employee handbook, information and assistance tally logs, the referral process, exactly how do they process referrals. Also, if their vehicles are not registered with STARS, you're going to need to see the vehicle maintenance log. The board of director file, it should include the minimum of the minutes, agendas, any flyers for whatever meetings that were held, the approved board roster, and any resolutions that came up, the board came up with and got approved. Also, we're going to need access to the client's files when the program manager comes out for the assessment. So in the engagement letter, I didn't mention, but in the letter, it says that you should have someone duly available to help the program manager doing the assessment, because we're going to need to access these clients' files. So it should be someone who's able to access the files, also print the files that we need during the assessment. That usually takes about 2 to 3 days. So we're also going to need documentation when we visit a senior center. And those are senior centers that are on the AAAs that are single parishes, and the COAs under the multis. So for senior centers, we're going to need to see the goals and objectives. Also, the policy and procedures, the mission statement, the grievance form, and the procedures for the grievance form. Also, the menus for the senior centers. The calendar of events to see exactly what you have coming up. Also, we're going to need to see those donation amounts for the signage. The code of conduct, very important. And also, at senior centers, any staff or volunteers should be certified in CPR, first aid, and bug bomb management. So we're going to need to see their certifications, whether they're a staff member or a volunteer.
What do you do with the staff member who cannot do the first aid CPR?
Ma'am?
She can't receive the card given her certification because she
right.
can't pass part. But she can't do part two.
Right.
And she can do the training part. She cannot do the management, but the instructor cannot submit her name through her certification because she has not done the management.
Did y'all accept and have certificate training part of the class?
That's something I'll have to we'll put on the table. I'll definitely address it in management to find out what's, you know,
question on here? Because
even though we pass out the cards, right, still put your questions. We'll try to answer as what we can today, and if we don't answer today, we'll get back with you, okay? Make sure you put your name, of course, in your counting.
What can you expect once the completion of the program assessment is done? The program monitor will conclude the assessment with an exit interview with the board director and at least one board member. It doesn't have to be the president, vice president, secretary, or treasurer. As long as they're on the board, they can be there for the exit exam. And remember, the date that the assessment will end is always on the letter, so you can kind of, you know, let the board member know when they should be to the council to expect this exit interview. Upon completion, a written report will be submitted from our office to your office 7 days after it is concluded. So once we leave the assessment, in 7 days, we're going to either email you a letter or send a letter in the mail to you. Once you receive the findings, you have 15 days to respond to the findings of the report. It is very important that you respond to the findings of the report, of the assessment.
So you all have changed the upon completion part just within sending 30. Out this book? I mean, you said 30 days.
Yeah, we had to make an adjustment, a correction, yes, yes. So what you see on the PowerPoint is the correct time frame. So it's up, go back, Charlene. Go back.
To the letter?
To the last, the previous slide.
This one?
Yes. So up on the written report will be submitted 7 days after assessment by the program monitor. And then you have 15 days to respond to that response, okay?
Business days,
yes.
Okay, so I have a few plus one question. To just check your knowledge. So the first question, how many days in advance will your program monitor notify you of a field assessment? Is it A, 7 days, B, 15 days,
30.
C, 30 days, or D, 60 days?
C.
Yes, 30 days.
Your engagement letter, yes.
You get the letter, yeah, 30 days in advance. Question two. To eliminate distractions and increase work efficiency, please provide your most recent financial statement.
B,
a quiet place where your program monitor can work. C, all the above. D, none of the above.
B.
All.
Probably.
Yes. It is B, a quiet place where the program monitor can work. So when we do the program assessment as a program monitor, we will not be looking at any financial information. That is for finance and accounting.
That is correct.
All finance is finance and accounting. We only work with services, units of service. The program monitor should conduct an exit conference with the agency director and the assistant director, board member, bookkeeper, none of the above.
Board member.
Ooh, they all know the board member. And my last question, I'm going to ask that someone raises their hand to answer it because I had a prize. A token of my appreciation. You came in today. Question four, a written response to the findings observed.
Everyone should know this one. You all get a prize. Can you send them forward and we can try to address those now? That asks, how would you recommend it to form a log? So basically, you can create your own log that indicates the actual the client's name, the service that they're actually having to be. You know, that would be the topic really, because you can have personal care, you can have chore, you can have homemaker, right? So you can have three different logs depending on what actual service that you're actually providing.
Can you repeat that? What you just read in the beginning.
I'm sorry. So we have a question, and the question says, how would you recommend in-home service log activities? So I was just giving a general statement on, you could probably just, if you have three different services, you want to have three different logs for those services. And you can, of course, include the client's name, and then how you actually, like, as far as the hours that they're getting those services, you want to make sure you have a tally of that. Okay? Does that answer that question?
So piggybacking on that,
mm-hmm.
Well, Sky Sam's, you're able to pull a report. Would that be sufficient to pull the report with the name, with the hours of service for the month?
So in actuality, you should have a log yourself, what you're doing before you actually put it into Sam. So that's like a cross check.
Yeah. Well, what we do at Union,
mm-hmm.
is we have like homemakers.
Okay.
The homemakers have a check sheet of what they do.
Mm-hmm.
Then those check sheets, I put how many hours they did, give it to our secretary.
And they put it into Sam. Okay.
So whenever you came in to do our audit, would you want to see all of those sheets from a certain month?
So we will actually, when we come in, we'll determine what month we're coming to look at it. However, we would look at what your homemaker service provider, the log from that, because we actually have access to the report from Sam's. So we'll be comparing that information as well. So that's why it's important for you to have your own log itself, yourself, and within your agency that you have as far as your cross reference.
So whenever I get on every week, I need to be putting them into a spreadsheet.
Yes,
saying,
you can.
Okay.
You can. However, whatever easy for you, but if you already have that log, if you have a log and you just keep them separated by month or by week, however you choose to do.
We don't keep any, other than the individual sheets, the
participants. Oh, the individual sheets.
Signs.
Okay, so yeah, you can create I would suggest creating a log with that information. Yes.
Is the question referring more to the log itself or the service or the case note in the folder?
She's referring, well, this question, are you familiar?
Referring more to the log itself.
The log itself, yeah, that's what
I
was reading.
Yeah. We don't keep an individual log.
Right. And of course, when we come out in October, when we start coming out in October, it's going to be preliminary. So it's no right or wrong. We're going to be assisting you in every effort to get you back on track, okay? So it's not going to be a right or wrong, oh, you did this wrong, oh, you did this right. We're just coming out to see where you are, okay? So no need to get all flustered at this time, but we're here to provide assistance
on how to do it better.
Yes, if we see something that needs, as far as making any type of corrections, we'll address those. But it won't be a right or wrong situation.
Can I ask quickly, is that sufficient? Because we do the same thing. Is that sufficient if we keep those daily sheets that they go into those homes, if I keep all of that file monthly, is that sufficient?
That's still sufficient. So I guess your process, whenever you have those logs, the daily, so you take those and you input it into Sam's. Am I correct?
Yes.
So that's an easy process for you, right?
Yes. Exactly.
Okay.
There it is.
Yeah.
And then we keep that.
As long as you have some type of supporting documentation where we can go and look at that. That's the purpose of us looking to see how those services are being provided. That makes sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. We're doing an annual assessment. The lighting in here is going to my eyes. Okay, we're doing an annual assessment, reassessment. Do all foreign confidentiality agreements need to be re-signed? So whenever you're doing your reassessment, I guess this is the question that, and I don't know who wrote it, but make sure I'm answering it properly. So of course, whenever you're doing your reassessment, yes, you need to go back and do the confidentiality and reason so that the individual still knows that that is still available. They actually know that, you know, they can file a grievance if need be. You still continue to do the same process over when you're doing your reassessment.
So they need to sign new forms at that time?
The reassessment, yes.
Yeah, do a new one every year.
I'm
talking about you need to do a new form.
Yes.
Every two years.
Every 2 years,
yes.
You do a reassessment.
Often that individual situation may change.
Right.
So when you're doing a reassessment,
it's to be on the same form in different English. And that's going to be in our next course.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yes. But you resign forms every year.
I'm sorry.
I just want to clarify. I know we have to do the reassessment form.
But you're talking about confidentiality.
I'm talking about the release of information, basically. And you're also talking about the grievance form. Both of those also have to be filled out new as well.
Yes. So they can be aware of it. Yes. Because you're actually reassessing that individual. Yes.
So we would add that to the
So you're saying, okay, they have that initial assessment. They come in and complete their assessment and their other form. You can have them sign. Okay, let's go ahead. Because when you do your reassessment, you're using that same form. So you can use your same form over. But when you're completed a new assessment after that second year, you do your form over.
Right. So
that's what. That's the comparison. Yes.
So on the.
Yes. Everything.
On the first, where we call it redlining, you know,
redlining. Yes.
When we get to that. Confidentiality.
You can have them sign
again
and put that date
a second signature.
Yes.
The new date.
Yes. The new date that matches the reassessment date on that law form. That makes sense now?
Okay. I understand about the sign. But my question is, what's been happening at our agency, what the interviewers is doing when they go out to do. And we give signatures from the initial assessment.
Correct.
Okay, when they do
the reassessment,
what they've been doing is signature on file.
Oh, that's wrong.
All they need to be going finding.
So the client themselves.
You can use the same form.
Right, we use the same form every time.
Okay.
But what they're doing is, because I know that I was how to do it, but I'm just saying. So what I have noticed from reviewing their paperwork is saying signature on file. So that is not permissible. They have to have that client signature. However many reassessments they do on
that. Now
they're
only
using
that form, the first initial, and then the second, you can use the same form again, but then you should do another form completely. The next year.
Okay, so if you do an initial reassessment, then you go back and do it complete.
Right.
And then, so you're just really doing this.
Completely going over the cycle over and over.
But on year two, when you redline,
correct.
You still get another signature.
Yes.
We have to go back. Well, they still try. I have to stay online because I'm still trying to. Oh, but we could do it by phone. I said, no. I told Joe Briggs that you are back at home. There's there. Joe Briggs and you can see your workers are at home to work. Because you can't do an assessment like that.
Same thing, okay, this is another question as it relates to, I think, this is your thing as well. Same thing with the vehicle maintenance laws.
What are you referring to, vehicle maintenance laws?
So if you, do you all
have our own vehicle?
You own it, so, okay, so you have drivers as far as the maintenance on it. How often are you doing maintenance on those vehicles?
So,
do you have a law for that?
Every week I have them sign a vehicle inspection saying they checked all the fluids.
Okay.
The
well, that's your law.
And they can be lying, but whatever. That's and then we also, in each individual, we keep a folder for each individual vehicle every time they have
a flat or whatever, whatever maintenance. Gotcha.
So, you know, we would just pull it for that vehicle.
Yes. Huh? Yes. That's it. That's correct.
Okay. Wait, the vehicle's on the
house. Yes. Yes.
So this question says, how necessary is it to capture a signature of a client who has called to enroll only for transportation and never come into the city? So your transportation driver can actually take that log in and have that individual sign. Okay. That makes sense? And then, are C1 signatures as important as C2? Yes, all signatures are. Yes, absolutely. We need everybody's signatures. Yes. So say you have a client that has not come into the center, and of course they only are receiving transportation as their service. So how are you able to obtain their signature? Well, you can have your transportation driver have that log and have that participant's signature based on it.
We also have transportation driver bring them to the office
and have them yes. So however whatever the most convenient scenario. Every scenario and every case is different, but you have to treat it as such.
What if the council is no longer under the umbrella of the DOTD?
If you're no longer
under, we don't even log in to start.
So you should have your own logs.
We do have that.
Okay.
We do pick up some clients and take them to the grocery store.
Okay.
Or something like that.
So you do have logs for those individuals. Yes. I mean, as far as your vehicle maintenance and then, of course, logs for those individuals who receive the transportation. Okay. Well, you're fine. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Then let me ask you. Are you talking about going back to the vehicles? Are you talking about vehicles and all vehicles, or like the only vehicles we transport clients will go under the OTD.
Okay.
I do have one or two vehicles for administrative purposes.
Okay.
Only.
No,
that's just one that are
senior
services.
Transportation.
Services.
Yes. Okay. Services.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So I think I may have covered all of them, and some of them will have to get back to you as far as email. We will definitely be reaching back out to you.
So tomorrow's session is
going to
be something else
you're going to
say?
So it's going to be the same. Tomorrow's session, all the sessions are going to be the same.
Oh.
So whatever you don't get to sit in on today, you can go sit in on tomorrow.
Okay.
So it's going to be a repeat of the same thing, same information.
Okay.
Okay.